Hey everybody, it's ShadowBlazer3000 here, and I just got out of Mirai, the new Mamorou Hosoda film. New-ish, I guess it's been out a little while now, but it's just now hitting theaters for the special Fandango events here in the United States and probably Canada, I think. Anyway, yeah, I just saw Mirai, also known as Mirai of the Future, and well, I'm gonna go ahead and kind of do a quick vlog for you guys. I was hoping to try and make this another Geek News Reviews and Opinions group cast here, group review, much like we did for Boy and the Beast a couple years ago, but as such, life is just pretty busy for everybody right now, especially for Drac. He's got two kids, which is really fitting here because I figured, hey, this will be a pretty good movie for him. I mean, it's about a little boy, little sibling trying to cope with jealousy of his older sister. But man, this is a movie I think he'll really relate to a lot, and I'm even gonna have to show it to my older sister, because I mean, she's pretty casual as anime fandom goes, so, but I think she'll get a real kick out of this too. I think she'll find some real enjoyment too, and I think even my two little nieces, well, eventually that day will come, but anyway, so let me kind of get into it. I'll try and give you a quick spoiler-free rundown, then maybe I'll do a little bit of spoiler talk here. So, quick spoiler-free to start with, beautiful-looking film, as to be expected. Hosoda is a master of his craft, acts very well animated, excellent animation. Really like the character designs. It's got that, you know, simplistic hand-drawn freeform style that I think we've come to associate with. It's the ever slowly fading away art, but it looks very nice. I mean, there is definitely a heavy use of CGI in the film, but only for certain aspects of it. Everything else is hand-drawn. The backgrounds are hand-drawn. The sets are hand-drawn. Everything in this is really just, it's a gorgeous looking film. The voice acting, in particular, I saw the dubbed version, and it's very nice. It's done by NYAV Post. They've become kind of the top dog dubbers lately. Jeez. And, you know, which is funny, because it's like, it used to be, New York was never quite associated with quality dub, because it's like, you either got the really rough, rocky Central Park media dubs of the, you know, late 90s, early 2000s, or, you know, you got the 4Kids stuff. But, of course, New York has really become the go-to place for anything quality dubbing-wise now. So you got Michael Centre-Nicholas, who directed Your Name and A Silent Voice in the director's chair. Oh, maybe he didn't direct A Silent Voice directly. He might have only assisted in that. And you got a little assistance from Stephanie Shea again. So once again, our top dog directors, our top dubbing directors in the chair again. And one thing it definitely sounds like it, and based on the credits, I'm going to assume this is true. Sounds like they must have gotten some real child actors for this. Pretty unheard of in most anime. I mean, voice acting's tough enough. Trying to get real children to do it, that's got to be even tougher. It's pretty rare when you get real children, considering the demands, the time, and the expense it takes to dub a movie. So, and they did this for A Silent Voice too, so my hat really goes off to them. They find some really good talent, some really good young actors, some good voices. The mother sounded familiar. I can't quite place a name to the face, though. It might just be my imagination. In fact, older Mirai, because this is not really a spoiler. This is pretty much the whole plot, is the story of how the boy will constantly interact with his sister from the future. I think she's not like a real seasoned dubbing vet. I think, not to say she doesn't have voice acting experience. I think she's mostly a video game actress. But, you know, top-notch acting by her and whoever played the little boy, little coon, which I'm assuming is a child again. Just absolutely wonderful. Story-wise, it really was enchanting. I mean, coming off The Boy and the Beast, which I thought was a little, which was okay. I thought it was a good movie, but it was a little rocky in places. But it's continuing along the sort of theming that Hosoda's been doing with his last several films, since Summer Wars, really, and that is finding the themes of family. In this case, it's a lot of the movie, of course, is the perspective of the little boy, Kun, but you also get the perspective of the parents and kind of the struggles they're going through now, having to raise two children, two very young children, mind you. It's like Kun can't be, I'd probably wager Kun can't be older than 3 years old, maybe four at the most, because Cerny's still just barely potty trained at this point, you know, still in that learning phase. But yeah, you hear that the stresses that they have to deal with. The mom, of course, is wondering, will she be a good, is she a good mom? Is she a good mother to her two children? You know, the dad is very much like Drac right now. See what I mean? This movie's gonna be so relatable to them. Because the mom goes back to work. A little bit of spoiler here, but... And the dad stays home. And in between that, you always see how Kun kind of comes to interact with his older sister. And in all the creative ways imaginable. It's very much like kind of that blend of fantasy and reality. I guess you could argue it definitely takes place in reality. And that this is all truly happening. It's not just Kun's imagination. Anyway, that's kind of the gist I got out of it. It's a truly solid family film. It's a beautiful looking film. If you've not had a chance to see it, if sadly you're going to miss your opportunity in theaters, I hope, hopefully maybe G-Kids will get a few more screenings out, but I'm sure it'll hit Blu-ray and DVD. G-Kids does actually get to publish Blu-rays and DVDs, where 11 Arts is now just barely kind of getting into that market. But thankfully, I have a good feeling this will hit Blu-ray soon, or I hope soon, because again, I really, really want to give this to Drac to watch, because he's going to get such an experience out of it, I feel like. Or he'll hate it because it doesn't have giant robots. I'm kidding, I give him such crap. Okay, that's kind of going to end the spoiler talk, so let me go ahead and really kind of get into the nitty-gritty. Sorry, that was the spoiler-free talk. Let me get into the real nitty-gritty of things here. So, as I mentioned, the story is mostly from Kun's point of view. He is a little child. He's probably 3 or 4 years old. And he's having to cope with having a new baby sister. And the baby sister, of course, does get a lot of his parents' attention. And Kun is naturally very childlike. I mean, he throws tantrums. He wants his parents' attention a lot. And, you know, I gotta imagine for probably those of us who don't have kids, especially those of us who do work retail, it's gonna take a little time to settle into, but then you gotta remember, we were all like that at one point. We all were children who probably threw temper tantrums over silly things. So, the first real encounter Kun has is with his dog, named Yoko? I think he was Yuko. And the dog is voiced by Crispin Freeman. Crispin, I missed you. And you kind of get, the dog kind of went through the same thing when Kun was born. And it's like, this is what's real fun about the movie. It's not just him meeting his older sister, as the plot summary tells you. He also gets to meet other figures out of his family. He gets to meet his dog. He gets to meet his great-grandfather. He gets to meet himself in the future. He gets to meet his mom as a little girl. And they're all really just great little set pieces all the time. And you always see, how does it connect? How does it relate? How does it all come together? And what's really good, and I think this is something Hosoda did really, really well here in his writing here, especially compared to The Boy and the Beast, which had a bizarre connection to Moby Dick out of nowhere, which doesn't make a lot of sense, because it's like, wait, Moby Dick is usually used as an allegory for obsession. How does that relate to the story of The Boy and the Beast? But anyway, Hosoda really always makes the little plans and payoffs. It's something I think a lot of writers overlook when you weave a big tapestry of a story. They call it Chekhov's gun, right? You set up a plot point, you pay it off. And they do that. And Hosoda does that here. He When they talk about Kun's great-grandfather, how he had a bad leg, and how there was a old family legend that he raced his great-grandmother to win her heart in marriage. And you go back in time and you get to see that. And of course, you also get to see that his great-grandfather was a motorcyclist enthusiast. And you understand why his leg was bad, because he served in the war. And then, of course, you see that Kun's mother, as a little girl, was also a little bit of a little terror herself. There's this whole bit where she and Kun play together, and boy, they trash the house. Oh my god. Oh, I was like, that poor little girl is going to get such a beating. Probably doesn't happen, at least. But you do hear the mom really scream, which is Kun's grandmother, that is. You hear that the mother scream really hard. And again, it's nice how the scenes all kind of really interconnect to each other. The first time Kun really meets his big sister from the future, you know, Mirai of the future, is they have to put away these dolls, because according to old legend, these dolls that are put out for the blessing of the baby girl signify when the baby girl will find marriage in her future life. And of course, the sister wants to make sure that the dolls get put away on time, because the legend says if you don't put the dolls away in time, it will put off marriage for every time, for however long the dolls are left out. So, you know, a little clever bit of old folklore there that I never knew about that. I never heard that, actually. It's the first time I've ever heard it. And, of course, Kun's love of trains. Well, how does the movie come to a great climax here? He comes to Tokyo in the future to a big train station, and he meets this robot. And he wants to tell the robot his family, but he doesn't remember his mom or dad's name, and so he's got to go to the scary looking black bullet train, and it's really creepy. The atmosphere is ominous, and oh, it is scary. There's some nightmare fuel in this. I still think it's a good movie for little kids. Just be a little bit aware there is some scary bits in it, but it's no worse than Little Nemo, Adventures in Slumberland, which is something I watched as a little tiny child. So if I could handle that, and I'm a complete wimp, by the way, and always have been, your kids or any kid you might know who's really little could probably be okay with Mirai. Like I said, there's some scary moments, but just remember that. If you could handle Little Nemo, Adventures in Slumberland as a kid, and you probably did, I don't know if you did, but I did, you'll be fine with Mirai. But the train station sequence is probably one of my favorite scenes out of it, because, again, it is pretty ominous. And, of course, it is that penultimate moment where Kun does come to accept his baby sister. Aww. Right, the train, because she's about to go be pulled into the train. It's like Kun has to escape the train before it leaves the station. It's just, like I said, it's a really ominous atmosphere and creepy scene. And you get this long tracking shot that sweeps down the corridors into this dark hallway, and the photography is amazing. This was a really good movie. It really was. I mean, I'm gonna probably be gushing about this movie. Is it, say, my favorite next to Wolf Children and Summer Wars? Let time sink it in a bit, but I'd say it is definitely a step up from The Boy and the Beast, which was Hosoda's first solo writing endeavor, and which had some rough patches. But again, that was not a bad movie by any means. I think that's really going to do it for this quick review of Mirai. Hope to see it on Blu-ray real soon. Really, really want to show this to Drac, because I think him as a parent of two children, he's really going to be able to connect with it. If he doesn't, I will eat my hat. I don't have a hat, so I guess I won't have to eat it. But it was a fantastic movie. I really loved it. So many great set pieces, beautiful animation. It's a crying shame this movie underperformed so hard at the box office. I'm talking the Japanese box office. I hope it finds a second wind in international markets. Because it really deserves a lot. it deserves a lot better than it really received, and I don't know what the heck it was, just bad timing or what, but the movie did not do very well in its home country, so let's hope it will perform a little better. Thanks, guys. I'm ShadowBlazer3000.